Welcome, please, to the panel, Janet Street Porter, who I'm sure needs no introduction, but I will give her one anyway. Janet began studying architecture but switched to journalism and was a Fleet Street columnist by the age of 21 before moving into television. She is a regular TV presenter, an award-winning producer, and joins us fresh from live broadcasting on Loose Women. So very lucky to have her dash across London to be with us. Janet has said, amongst one or two other things you may have heard Janet say over the years, that Twitter is a load of hot air used by advertisers to sell products and won't deliver the same results as mainstream television. So we'll explore that in a second. On my right is Sue Llewellyn, a former BBC reporter and producer with more than 15 years' experience as a journalist in the TV newsroom, so lots of experience right across the comms mix. Prior to that, she was communications director for the Born Free Foundation, which is an amazing global charity, as I'm sure you all know. And since leaving the BBC a few years ago, has been delivering social business strategy and bespoke social media training for a wide range of media and charity clients. Sue doesn't think that old media is dead, but thinks that new media, social media, has a real role to play, but you've got to get it right. And we were just saying this about the message, about the stuff that you put forward, so we'll explore that in a bit more detail. And Adam Baker, last but not least, on my left, is a serial technology entrepreneur, having founded three web businesses since 1999. His latest blotter is changing the way news is gathered and reported globally, and has grown into the largest network assistant journalist within Europe. Adam thinks that it's never been, the media landscape has never been as efficient or timely for sharing content. So it's firmly on the new social media side of the debate. Should we be concentrating all of our efforts on the mainstream media, particularly in an environment where resources in the charity sector have never been slimmer? Or should we be forgetting pitching to the editor of The Independent and trying to get onto Loose Women and The One Show and putting all of our eggs in Adam's basket? And concentrating our resources entirely on digital media. Is it time to forget the mainstream press and move on? Is that a bit yesterday? Well, let's start with Sue.
I definitely don't think old media is dead. I think that you should be concentrating your efforts in both places, but it's entirely dependent on the audience that you're looking for. You can't just go and say, I'm on a Facebook page and expect that to work. You need to think strategically about how you're going to do this. But I do think the relationship's changing, and I do think you have a massive amount to offer old media.
Janet, surely you don't need a strategy to tell you that somebody once said, I'm not sure who this was, Twitter is home to the dull and dysfunctional. I will never join.
I'm not going to completely rule out Twitter, but at the moment, presenting a programme like Loose Women, which is on 5 days a week and is a live show, gives you access, if you can get on it, to such a massive audience. Because I've never realised, you know, when you present TV programmes now, they never tell you how many times it goes out. They keep it quite dark, because obviously you'd be asking for more money. And we get our contracts all by us. So I discovered today that the episode that I've just done that went out live is now going out on ITV1 from 1:30 to 2:30. It's going out on ITV2 at 4:40 and ITV2+1 at 5:40 to 6:40. That one programme is actually going to be transmitted six times at three different channels at six different times a day. And the first transmission gets approximately 1.5 to 1.6 million viewers. What Sue said is right, that there is a place for social media and Twitter as part of a charitable campaign. And you've just seen with SportsAid, which raised 52 million quid, the success traditional media. SportsAid wouldn't raise 52 million quid unless it was absolutely going out at prime time on a major television channel. If you can simplify the message that you want to get across, work more coherently together, you will have more success with the very hard to get into traditional media. I think that you must never give up on targeting the prime television channels and the mass market newspapers. But to achieve success, you've got to get your act together and work in a way which we find easy to understand.
You make a great point about Lewis Women and their reach and their audience, how many times it goes out. But I mean, in this room here, how many of these individuals are actually going to get onto Lewis Women? Realistically, not very many. I think what we all need to do is to be really proactive in being able to control our own communications plan. And social media enables us to do that. And one thing that social media is very good at is being able to build your own audience. And Twitter is especially good at this. So, for example, you as a PR individual, you should be looking at the influencers that are on topic for you and following them and making sure they follow you back. And every time you blog, you can then post that to your audience, and it's guaranteed to get an audience. Whereas I think you can spend a lot of time building up relationships with big mainstream TV and newspaper organisations and get nowhere with it. You can control social media, and so for us, we use social a lot more than we try to get onto the Daily Mail or Sky News.
And how many charities realistically are going to get 100,000 followers on Twitter? And so you could spend years building up, 200, 300, even 2,000 followers. It's a drop in the ocean, isn't it?
No, I disagree. So you probably will spend years trying to get onto Lewis Women, and you won't.
That's how you build your brand.
I'm not sure. I think you've got to get brand equity before a mainstream news organisation will be interested in publicising you. With Twitter, okay, the 100,000, maybe that's kind of the holy grail. But even if it's not that difficult to build 10, 15,000 users if you have an engaged strategy to do so.
TV come before the Twitter? I mean, it's all Stephen Fry got those number of followers on Twitter, but would he have if he had a media career beforehand? Does the TV feed Twitter?
Well, it's undoubtedly that the celebrity element drives the followers, brings the followers in. Yeah. But that doesn't necessarily mean that they are that influential. Yeah. It's all about influence. So if you're aiming at influencers and building your supporters into advocates, that's where you really will win using social media. So it isn't all about the numbers. It isn't all the quantitative. It's the qualitative stuff. It's the relationship building. I think that's really where you'll benefit from this.
I think the key to in all is to establish the personality. How you get a charity onto television or into the pages of the Daily Mail is not just to have a good cause, but to have built a brand that is unmistakable and not confused with another charity, and you ally that to a human story. Because the newspapers and television shows rely on human stories.
To people in mainstream media, to people react in the same way, do you think, as they do on social media? Do you think you talk to people as directly, or do they watch that human story, over dinner, and then go off and do something different? Is it better to talk to 5,000 people on Twitter that might actually engage?
But what do you want to do? The people on Twitter, you don't know where they are, if they've got any money or not money. The point of all the people in this room have got one aim in life, and that's to extract money for their charities from members of the public. So don't deviate from that. You don't want friends. You want their cash.
You also want them to do stuff for you. So it's not necessarily about the money. It could be that they will be hugely influential in people doing stuff.
You want them to act. You want them to act.
You want them to act. Yeah. You want them to get motivated.
So and unfortunately, isn't the problem with Twitter that it's a lot of this? It's a lot of tapping. It's not a lot of acting. It's a lot of twitching on a keyboard.
Social media makes up about 40% of our traffic.
Right.
It's significant. And that's because I think we've got interesting content, we've got exclusive content, but also because from a viral perspective, it's very easy just to share stuff around. You're absolutely right, it's not about numbers really. It's about relevance and if you've got a relevant audience of people that are following you because they believe in your charity, they support your charity, then you've got a really good audience, whether that's 1,000 people or 100,000.
How much do you think social media is driven by the TV. I mean, Janet said you're trending after appearing on Question Time. Doesn't it always start with the mainstream?
The interesting point you made, Jack, there was that if it's a brand, then the mainstream media will cover it. For the smaller brands, I think social media is absolutely essential because you've got to build your brand before people begin to take you seriously and trust the information that you're giving them.
And is that, Janet, something that you know, mainstream media just can't compete with?
As the number of television and news channels has grown exponentially, the demand for news and stuff to fill them with is massive, so no one's going to turn down a decent story.
I mean, surely just being one of a number of millions of voices on Twitter or Blotter or Facebook or wherever it is means that you just can never cut through as you could if you get on the ITN lunchtime news, or can you cut through?
Yeah. It's very, very, very difficult to get mainstream attention, to get coverage in the mainstream media, and you can build an audience on social media and you can get your message out.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, it's a symbiotic relationship. The two things work together. It's not an either or, it's both together, but it's entirely up to you to decide who your audience are and what the messages you're delivering. And if you're talking to mainstream media, make sure that you're delivering what they need. You know, you've got a lot of rich content there, they need that. There's a demand for news all the time, so you can supply it.
If we had mainstream media on the on to the left of that list, so you know, on the see it end, and we've got social media on the right of that list, or the share it end, would you agree that that's the scale that it goes?
No. More people are now watching video than they're watching television. Fact. So YouTube social media. So and you can get a video on YouTube,
yep,
instantly. Television is absolutely about see it, but I think social media has become that as well.
No, I don't agree, because I think television is something that you watch with your friends and you talk about, or with your family. I do think that YouTube has a part to play, and I think it is really important, but it's something you kind of flick in and flick out of. Why does the BBC have comic relief, sports relief and whatever relief? Because they get ratings. It's not, yes, it's about the charity, but let's be really cynical about it. Fulfills their remit, gets a massive audience of all age groups.
The thing that is huge now is social TV, the two-screen TV, as you said at the beginning, Joe, there might be sort of terrible comments you're getting, but there is a huge thing where people are watching television with their family, yes, and their friends, and they're talking on social, yeah, media, so I think it spreads it much further. I think everybody gets very hung up on verification, and rightly so. Social media is a way of accessing all sorts of different content now, and much more speedily. It doesn't mean because we have a new toy to play with that we should forget the rules of being a journalist. We should absolutely verify everything that comes through, because obviously there's a lot of misinformation out there. But this is where charities could be very useful, because you can be the people, you know, saying that this information is actually correct. You could be the fact checkers, you know, or providing the audio, the video, the case studies, all of the things. So it will make journalists' lives a lot easier.